High Court. Ma'am has experience of a decade on a broad range of topics, including mainstream commercial litigation and arbitration. Over the last few years, a major thrust of her practice has been infrastructure projects and road projects. Regularly represent prestigious PSU, governmental bodies, MNC, MSME on a wide spectrum of matters before various courts, forums, Supreme Court, Delhi High Court, and other high courts, and several tribunals and commissions. Have argued several landmark and crucial reported judgments. Today, ma'am will be speaking on the provisions of Limitation Act 1963 with respect to insolvency and arbitration proceedings. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Kriti. Thank you for the introduction. And thank you so much, Nitesh, for having me over. The topic of today's webinar is Limitation Act and its applicability to arbitration procedure and insolvency procedure. Now, I believe we all have a fair idea as far as Limitation Act 1963 is concerned, that it comprises of the time limits, and at the same time, it provides the computation of these time limits for filing of suits, appeal, and other legal procedures. Now, what is important is that there is this doctrine of LAP, and LAP means limitation and prescription. And there are certain consideration, and that is the reason why this Limitation Act is in place. The first consideration is mostly the long dormant cases, they have more cruelty in them than justice. So if you are not pursuing your case and you are not doing anything about it for long, and after a certain period, if you just go ahead and initiate that case, then such an action will amount to cruelty. Now, secondly, there is another consideration that the right in property and right in general cannot enjoy the state of suspense or uncertainty for long, because then I'll never know that when you're going to initiate a legal action against me. Third is that mostly when the claims are stale or the rights become stale, the other side is not expected to protect or secure the evidence for this long. And then generally, if you have a good cause of action, you pursue your remedy promptly. And if you have not exercised your right for long, then it means that your right doesn't exist. I'll just clarify here that non-existence of right as far as Limitation Act is concerned doesn't mean that your rights are diminished. All it means is that your rights are no longer enforceable. So your rights become unenforceable in the eyes of law. And this 89th law report of the Law Commission of India, which has very, very, in a very simple manner, opined why Limitation Act is important. One, justice, convenience, and then encouragement to be diligent. That's our introduction. Now, what I've done is that I've prepared one PowerPoint presentation, and in the PowerPoint presentation, I've demarcated this entire discussion into three parts. So the first part is the Limitation Act. What we'll do is we'll cover the provisions of Limitation Act. While we are covering the provisions of Limitation Act, I'll request you to note down these sections, because you have to keep the section in mind while the moment we move to next part, that is part two, and then the last part, part three. In part two, we'll discuss the application of these provisions of Limitation Act vis-a-vis the Arbitration Act. And in the part three, we'll again see the applicability of these provisions with respect to the insolvency procedure. Now, just give me a second so that I share the PPT. Right. So if you see the framework, the first is relevant provisions of the Limitation Act. Second is application of Limitation Act to arbitration proceedings. Then there are certain subtopics. The first topic is limitation period for commencement of the arbitration, limitation period for challenging the award, and then 2.3, which is sections 11 and 29A of the Arbitration Act, and 2.4, other key takeaways. And the last topic is application of Limitation Act to insolvency proceedings. Now, moving to the provisions of Limitation Act 1963, as you can see, the first section is section 3.1, which is bar of limitation. In this case, one has to understand that even if the limitation is not pleaded, then the court is empowered to disallow any suit, any appeal, any application which is barred by limitation. And this limitation period is prescribed in the Limitation Act itself, and there's a schedule, and that schedule is divided into three divisions, which I'll come to later. Section 14 is expiry of prescribed period when court is closed. Section 4 means that in case the last day to file a certain suit or appeal, it lies on the day when the day is closed, then automatically the limitation would be extended, and then you can file your suit or appeal on the day when the day when the court is open. What is important to understand is that you have to file your suit or appeal or application as soon as on the immediate filing of the court. Otherwise, you won't be able to avail the benefit under Section 4. Section 5 is extension of prescribed period in certain cases. Now, Section 5 gives the court certain power to condone the delay. It says that if the party is able to show a sufficient cause, then in view of the justice, keeping the interest of justice in mind, the court can condone such delay. Section 12 says exclusion of time in legal proceedings. Now, what is important is, which I'll also come to later, is extension of time and exclusion of time. Extension of time is more like Section 5, wherein the court has condoned the delay and has allowed you to file a suit or an application in the extended period by condoning the delay. Whereas Section 12 talks about exclusion of time in legal proceedings. Now, this means that there are times when if I want to challenge an order, for that I have to apply for a certified. So whatever time is taken by the registry for the preparation of that certified, that will be excluded. Now, similarly, if there is a judgment which is pronounced on a certain date, so that date will be excluded. Similarly, there are other provisions in Section 12 which talks about exclusion of time in legal proceedings. Next is Section 14, exclusion of time of proceedings bona fide in court without jurisdiction. It means if I am pursuing a legal remedy before a wrong forum or before a court which lacks jurisdiction, and my case is bona fide otherwise, then this period, right, will reckon from my filing of the
Tanu, we cannot hear you. Tanu, we cannot hear you.
Hello. 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 Kriti, you are mute.
Hello. Hello, everyone. I request everybody to keep wait for 1 minute. The speaker will be right back within 1 minute.
Hi, Kriti. Can you confirm? Can you see me?
Yes, ma'am. I can see you.
All right. I just lost the internet connection. What I'll do is I'll again go for the screen sharing. Just give me a second, please. Right. I'll directly resume from where we stopped. Kriti, can you confirm that the last which I covered, is it section 12? Are you keeping the tab?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. So next is section 14, which is exclusion of time or proceeding bona fide in court without jurisdiction, which I just did cover before we lost the connection. And that is the time which we have spent pursuing a remedy before the wrong forum will be excluded. So that benefit will be given. And next is section 15, exclusion of time in certain other cases. It means that suppose there is a stay or there is an injunction, and because of that stay or injunction, you're not able to file a suit or you're not able to avail your remedy against the party who is enjoying that stay or injunction, then such time period of injunction will be excluded. Effect of fraud or mistake. In this case, suppose there is a judgment debtor, and that judgment debtor has played a fraud upon the decree holder. And because of that, the decree holder is not able to file an execution within the prescribed time period. Then that time period will be excluded. Importantly, there's an explanation to section 17, which says that this time period is of 1 year. So from the date of discovery of fraud, you will have another 1 year to file the execution. Effect of acknowledgement. This is very important. Now, acknowledgement means that as soon as you recognize the fact that there is a debt, mere communication or mere needless communication referring to a debt won't be an acknowledgement. You have to acknowledge the fact that, yes, this amount is payable. If that is the case, then your limitation will be revived and there'll be a fresh cause of action. Section 29, savings. Now, this clause is very important for today's discussion, because as far as saving is concerned, it means that if there is a special provision or there is a local law which prescribes for a different period as to what is prescribed under Limitation Act, then that period will be the relevant period for the purpose of limitation. Next is the applicability of Limitation Act to the arbitration. So the first question is whether the Limitation Act is applicable to arbitrations. Answer is clear, yes, because there's section 43 in the Arbitration Act, which talks about the fact that the limitation is applicable. However, what is important is to keep section 29, which is a saving clause under the Limitation Act, in mind, which means that in arbitration, if we see, there are certain clauses which provides for a different provisions. Within different time periods. So in that case, those time periods and those provisions will prevail over the Limitation Act, because it's a general act, whereas arbitration is a special act and it's a complete code in itself. If we see 43.2 provision, what I've done is I've divided this into four parts, and if you see the caption, the first caption is date of commencement. It says an arbitration shall be deemed to have commenced on the date referred in section 21. Now, section 21 of the Arbitration Act is when there is a request for reference or there is a request for invocation of arbitration clause. So as soon as you issue a letter for invocation of an arbitration clause, your arbitration has commenced. Second is extension of time. Where an arbitration agreement provides that a claim shall be barred unless some step to commence arbitration proceedings is taken within a period time fixed by the agreement, the court, if is of the opinion that in the circumstances of the case, undue hardship would otherwise be caused, and notwithstanding that the time so fixed has expired, may on such terms, if any, as the justice of the case may require, extend the time for such period it thinks proper. The court is required to take a liberal view of the expression undue hardship, and all the relevant circumstances should be taken into consideration. The relevant judgment is in Sterling General Insurance Company. In this case, the court has tried to study the word undue in term of undue hardship, and court has said that the liberal interpretation has to be given. However, it doesn't mean excess. That means it has to be something which is not undeserved or unmerited. Exclusion of time. Where the court orders that an arbitral award be set aside, the period between the commencement of the arbitration and the date of the order of the court shall be excluded. It means that suppose after your challenge to arbitration under Section 34, if the court decides that court decides to set aside an award and you want to re-agitate your claims, then this period of right from invoking the arbitration clause to the challenge or even an appeal for that matter will be excluded as far as the limitation is concerned. Limitation periods for the commencement of arbitrations. Limitation Act applies to all proceedings under the Arbitration Act, just as it applies to the proceedings in the court. Any arbitration proceedings commence after the limitation has to be 3 years. That means if you see Article 136 of the Limitation Act, and which is also called a residual clause, that means if the provision or the time period is not prescribed anywhere else, then the time period to file such an application will be 3 years. So keeping that in mind, that if a party has a claim, that claim has to be filed within 3 years' time. Otherwise, it will be time barred. For the purpose of limitation, an arbitration proceeding is deemed to commence on the date of request when the date of request is received from the other party. And there is this important aspect which one has to keep in mind. And it's a recent, by way of a recent judgment in Geo Miller, which I've mentioned in the last, it's a, in Geo Miller and Company versus Rajasthan Vidyut Utpam Nigam 2019. Now, this is the latest judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court, and it was a much required judgment wherein it says that if there is a time period which the parties have consumed in view of good faith of negotiation or discussions, and if this time period, whatever the time period is consumed, that has to be excluded, which means that suppose there is a claim of yours and you initiated the arbitration after the period, say, 4 years, but 2 to 3 years you consume only in negotiation, then that those entire period of 2 to 3 years will be excluded for the purpose of limitation. Section 34. Now, Section 34 is very important because Section 34 prescribes a very strict timeline. It means that if you want to challenge an award, it has to be 3 months plus 30 days. And even the court are powerless to condone the delay beyond 30 days. And this is a very settled law. I don't think so there's any confusion, any anomaly when it comes to timelines of Section 34. Therefore, Section 34 timelines with respect to Limitation Act is very important. If we see the starting point, and even as far as Section 34 is concerned, I've divided into certain stages. So the first stage is the starting point. Now, the starting point as far as Section 34 is concerned, the time when you receive an award, and that is the time when your when your right to challenge an award commences, and it has to be as per Section 31(5), which means it has to be a signed copy of the award and it has to be served upon the parties and no other. The relevant case laws is Union of India and Tecco Tricky. In this case, the court has emphasized that the delivery of an award has to be upon the parties, not even the counsel. Now, the counsel, being a authorized representative of a party, cannot collect the award. And if at all he will collect the award, then it won't be the service which is prescribed under the Arbitration Act. Another one is Radha Bai versus P. Ashok Kumar, Civil Appeal 5889 of 2009. In this case, the court has discussed the applicability of Section 17. What is important is that as far as 34 is concerned, Section 5, which empowers the court to condone the delay if the sufficient cause is shown, is not applicable because here the statutory timelines are fixed. So even the courts are powerless. So Section 5 is not applicable. However, as far as Section 17 is concerned, that is effect of fraud, even that is not applicable. So if tomorrow you say that although you received an award, but you wanted to settle, and the other party was playing a fraud upon you, and you the entire 3 months plus 30 days time period elapsed because you were under a bona fide belief that there is a chance of settlement, but the opposite party had a malafide intention, then even this Section 17 provision won't come to your rescue. However, what is important is if tomorrow you have a case wherein you say that I never received the award, or the receiving which they are showing is based on fraud because I have never received the award, then that ground will come to your rescue, because Section 31(5) says the receipt of an award is important, because only after receiving of an award, the time period to challenge the arbitration award commences. Now thereafter, if we see, it says that we can challenge the award within 3 months' time. Importantly, it is 3 months, not 90 days, not 89 days. It is 3 months. And Section 9 of the General Clause says, if it says from, so if we see from receiving of the award, it means the day on which you receive the award will be excluded. That is Section 9 of the General Clause Act. So if you receive an award today, which is first, so the time period won't start from first, it will start from second. So 2nd July and then 3 months. So last day of the 3 months starting from 2nd July. Relevant case law here is State of Himachal versus Himachal Techno 2010, 12 SCC 210. In this case, the Supreme Court extended this principle of Section 34(3). Thus, the time period for filing an application under 34 will commence a day after the receipt of the award. Same principle which I just mentioned. The time in between. Now, what is important is that once you have received an award, and that is a proper service under the Act, there is no way you can disable this time period. There is no way you can stop this time period. It will continue. And therefore, Section 9 of the Limitation Act, which provides that once you receive the award in a manner which is prescribed, then this time period begins to run. Apart from this, the only exception is Section 33, which can stop this running of the time period, and no other exception. And the last is the time period under Section 34(3) after the expiry of 3 months. Like I said, after 3 months, there is another time period which is 30 days. So within 30 days, the party can also file it, provided there is a sufficient cause. And again, the court has to see whether this cause is good enough for the condonation of delay. Section 4 of the Limitation Act is applicable even for 34(3), because if on a particular day the court is shut, then there is no way the filing can be done. So automatically the time will be extended, and you can file it on the immediate opening of the day. While proviso 34(3) proviso, which I have just discussed, which talks about the additional 30 days provided you have a sufficient cause, there are certain case laws which I'll mention. One is Union of India versus Popular Construction. In this case law, the court has again opined the fact that as far as Section 5 of the Limitation Act is concerned, it is not applicable, and the doctrine which has been discussed is express exclusion test, because it says, but thereafter the court cannot allow or condone such delay. So there's this express exclusion. Another case law which is relevant here is Yashwant Deora versus Walchand. This is 1951 case law. It talks about rule of equity. It says that even the rule of equity as far as 34(3) is concerned is not applicable, because again, there's this, you will have to apply the test of express exclusion. Now, there's a difference between extension of time and computation of time, I remember when I discussed Section 5 of the Limitation Act, I said this is extension of time, wherein the court can extend the time period for filing of that appeal while condoning the delay. And computation of time is different. Now, computation of time is, there are certain exclusions, like Section 4. If the court is not working on a particular day, then on the immediate opening of the court, you can file it. So suppose the court is not working on Saturday and Sunday, then these 2 days can be excluded. Similarly, there is certain time period which you consume for the in order to apply for a certificate, which a registry, sorry, which is registry consume in order to prepare for a certified copy. That time period will be excluded. Another judgment, which is the last judgment which I have mentioned, is Simplex Infrastructure versus Union of India. It says Section 14 of the Limitation Act does not provide for a fresh period of limitation. Next is there are key takeaways as far as Arbitration Act is concerned, Limitation Act implication in Arbitration Act is concerned. First is that, like I said, that Limitation Act is applicable to Arbitration Act, just like it is applicable to court civil proceedings. And Arbitration Act is a special law within a meaning of Section 29(2) of the Limitation Act, and hence it will have an overriding effect for certain purposes. Article 137 of the Limitation Act applies to arbitration, which means that the time to file your claim is 3 years, and thereafter it will be time barred. Any arbitration agreement which provides a shorter time period than one prescribed will be invalid in the eye of law. So if there's an agreement between the two parties that you can raise this claim only within a certain time period, which is less than 3 years, that period will be invalid, that agreement will be invalid per se. Arbitration agreement does not exclude the computation benefits under Section 4, 12, and 14, which I've already discussed. The Supreme Court Suo Motu took up the issue of extension of limitation by order dated 23-3-2020. Now, I believe this we all must be aware of, that the Supreme Court on 23rd March 2020 has stated that because of COVID situation, there are certain practical difficulties and there is no way the parties can offer physical filings. And even the traveling, you know, there's a lot of restrictions. So keeping all these practical difficulties in mind, the court for now has excluded this running of limitation. Section 37, appealable orders. Importantly, so far, the position before the High Court, at least Delhi High Court, was that generally under the Commercial Court Act, the parties were challenging the order from a single bench within the 60 days time. And thereafter, the parties, in case the challenge was beyond 60 days, the party were filing an application for condemnation of delay under the Limitation Act. And if there was a sufficient cause, such an application was entertained. However, in a recent judgment of Justice Rohinton passed by the Honorable Supreme Court, NV International versus State of Assam, it says that this delay cannot be condoned after 120 days. So to my understanding, the logic which has been opted is that it has to be 90 days plus 30 days, what has been mentioned in 34.4. So under 34.4, it says 3 months plus 30 days. So similarly, that logic has been extended to Section 37, saying that if you want to challenge an order passed by a single bench under single judge under 34, then it has to be within the prescribed period, which is 60 days. And if at all there is a delay beyond 120 days, it shall not be entertained. And as far as execution of the award is concerned, just like a decree, it is 12 years. Section 11, which talks about appointment of arbitration. Now, one has to understand that the Section 11 is a procedural law, which means that suppose I want to invoke an arbitration, and in my notice, I have named an arbitrator, or I have stated that both the sides, we can come together and we can appoint an arbitrator, and you fail to respond or you fail to concur to my choice of arbitrator, then the party within 30 days after the expiry of 30 days time can approach the court for an appointment of an arbitrator. Now, in these two judgments, which I've just mentioned, which is J.C. Buddhi Raja versus Chairman Odisha Mining, 2008 judgment, and another one is Prasar Bharati versus Ma Communication, 2010 judgment. In both these judgments, the Honorable Supreme Court has stated that there's a difference between Section 11 procedure, which is mentioned under the Act, and the claims. So in both these cases, the opposite parties have stated that the Section 11 application cannot be entertained by the court because the claim of the claimant are time barred. So what they're saying is that since these claims have been initiated after the expiry of 3 years, therefore the court cannot entertain Section 11. Court said no, as far as time barred claims are concerned, or as far as this plea is concerned, it has to be raised before an arbitrator, because Section 11 is, if you see, Section 11 is a merely a procedure wherein if the other party fails to respond or fail to concur to your choice of arbitrator, then both the parties can approach a court for an appointment of the arbitrator. Section 29A of the Arbitration Act states about the time-bound arbitration. Now, in under 2019 amendment, it says that after the completion of pleading, which has to be 6 months, the award has to be passed after within another 1 year. So, as far as subsection 29A is concerned, it's a salutary provision. However, in my takeaways, I've already mentioned that there's an order passed by the Honorable Supreme Court dated 23rd, 3rd, 2020. If you see, the Supreme Court has directed that it is hereby ordered that a period of limitation in all such proceedings, irrespective of the limitation prescribed under the general law or special law, like arbitration is a special law, whether condonable or not, shall stand extended with effect from 15 March 2020 till further orders. However, as far as the still further order status is concerned, it is continuing. Now, there was this another order which was passed by the Honorable Supreme Court during this COVID times, and that was on 6 May 2020, writ civil number 3 of 2020. In this case, the court has stated that as far as 29A of Arbitration Act is concerned, and again, Section 138 of the Negotiable Instrument Act is concerned, these timelines have in a way have been frozen. And in case your timeline, if your time period to initiate Section 29A proceedings or 138 proceedings is expiring within this lock-in period, then once this lock-in lock-in period is over, then you'll have another buffer time of 15 days. Now with this, arbitration act is over, and we will move to the last part, which is Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Now, when the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code was introduced or enacted, there was no provision as far as the limitation is concerned. And thus, there was this lot of anomalies. And time and again, NCLAT held a view that as far as Limitation Act is concerned, it is not applicable. But ultimately, the Honorable Supreme Court passed a judgment saying that the Limitation Act is applicable. And thereafter, there was also an introduction of a section, Section 238A. I'll just cover it one by one. If you come to the slide and you see, there's a judgment passed by the NCLAT, Mr. Black Pearl Hotel versus Planet M Retail. In this judgment, the NCLAT has held a view that Limitation Act, if at all, it is not applicable. And the NCLAT also went ahead and stating that if there is a cause of action which has accrued before the coming into existence of 2016 IBC code, then from the date of cause of action, you cannot compute your 3 years, because it has to be from the enactment of 2016 code. So that is the view which the NCLAT held. However, this view was set aside by the Honorable Supreme Court. And if you see next, which I've stated, status of an application under IBC filed beyond limitation on grounds of a pending money suit winding up petition, the Supreme Court in Jignesh Shah versus Union of India, writ petition 455. Now, the before initiating of IBC, people were filing winding up petition under the Companies Act. Similarly, people were also filing recovery suits. Now, what is important is that in case there was this matter which was filed by a party under the as a winding up petition, after coming into existence of IBC, it was assumed that this is in continuation. Although the parties were supposed to issue the fresh demand notice under the IBC, however, it was assumed that from the winding up, it is a continuous cause of action. But if the party has initiated a recovery proceeding, then it cannot be assumed as a continuous cause of action. The reason is that winding up petition or insolvency petitions or proceedings are not recovery proceedings. And therefore, one cannot say that the recovery proceeding is an extension of the IBC. And thus, those benefits were not provided. Section 238A, like I said, Section 238A was enacted on 6/6/2018, and by way of this section, it was made very clear that the Limitation Act is applicable as far as insolvency proceedings are concerned. I have reproduced this section. If you see, it says the provisions of the Limitation Act 1963 shall, as far as may be, apply to the proceedings of appeal, apply to the proceedings or appeal before the adjudicating authority like NCLAT, the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, the Debt Recovery Appellate Law Tribunal, as the case may be. But now I believe there is no confusion, there is no anomaly, because it has been made very clear that Limitation Act is applicable. Another question is that if you see, if I again go back, it is important to see that this Limitation Act is, this provision was introduced on 6/6/2018. Now we come to the question whether this application of this provision, will it be a retrospective application or prospective application? Now, this position has been made clear by the Honorable Supreme Court in the judgment BK Education Service Private Limited versus Prag, Gupta and Associates. In this case, the court stated in very clear terms that it has to be retrospective, otherwise the entire purpose to insert this clause would be defeated. Another point is right to sue accrues when the default has occurred. Now, if there is a debt, and I fail to pay the debt on a certain day. So from that date to the 2-3 years, the time period which I have is 3 years. And the view held by the NCLAT stating from the enactment of 2016 is not the date on which my right to sue accrues. My right to sue accrues from the date when the other party defaulted. Innovative Industries versus ICICI Bank Limited held that a debt may not be due if it is not payable in law or in fact. I'll just tell you the context of this case. Before this application of the provision, which I just mentioned, the NCLAT continuously held a view, at least at the very initial stage, that the Limitation Act is not applicable. And as far as debts which are time barred under the Limitation Act, those debts can be entertained by the court because ultimately it's not a recovery proceeding. And what one is asking is for the insolvency proceeding. But in this case, the Honorable Supreme Court, innovative case, the Honorable Supreme Court made it very clear that if this there is a debt by which a corporate debtor owes, but that debt has become time barred, that means that debt is no longer a debt, it is no longer payable. So therefore, even the insolvency proceedings cannot be initiated against such a corporate debtor. Applicability of Section 15 of the Limitation Act. This I've already discussed while we were discussing Limitation Act. I'll just give you a short example in this case so that you are able to appreciate it more. Suppose there is a proceeding before the BIFR. Under the SICA, wherein you cannot proceed against such a company who has been declared sick, and thereafter thereafter the court has been introduced. Now, for that period, for the date on which the BIFR proceedings were initiated, and then the BIFR passed an order stating that you cannot proceed against such a corporate debtor or such a company which has been declared sick under SICA. From that date till the date of the enactment, this entire date benefit you will be able to avail. I read out this provision. It says the period during which a stay, interim order passed by any authority is operative shall not be included for the purpose of determination of limitation period. Thus, if pursuant to an order of BIFR under SICA, a creditor was unable to take any action against a corporate debtor until introduction of the court, the period during which such creditor was barred by the order of BIFR shall be excluded for the purpose of determining limitation. So from the date on which the injunction stay order was passed by the BIFR till the enactment of the court, this entire period will be excluded. The similar view was taken by the NCLAT court in this judgment, which I have mentioned, is Mr. Gauri Prasad Goenka versus PNB. Section 18 is acknowledgement as far as insolvency proceedings are concerned, and acknowledgement is very, very crucial. If we see the form of acknowledgement, it can be through email, although it's not a signed document, but email under the Information Technology Act are being recognized. And therefore, if there is an email which wherein a corporate debtor has acknowledged the debt, it will be an acknowledgement under Section 18 of the Limitation Act. Similarly, if there is a balance sheet of a company and it has to be a signed balance sheet, and in that balance sheet you have recognized the debt, again, that will be read against a corporate debtor. Thereafter, there are other forms of acknowledgement like issuance of check or in the case of wherein the party has to pay EMIs. So once you pay the EMI, so you are acknowledging the fact that this much amount is due and therefore I'm paying this EMI or this installment or the part installment or the interest. Next, Section 66. Notwithstanding anything contained in the Limitation Act or in any law for the time being in force, in computing the period of limitation specified for any suit or application by or against corporate debtor for which an order of moratorium has been made under this part, the period during which such moratorium is in place shall be excluded. So the entire period wherein the CIRP proceedings are taking place, this entire proceeding, the CIRP period, which is moratorium period, it has to be excluded. The benefit has to be given. Section 61 talks about appeal to the NCLT. So the period is 30 days. You can challenge NCLT order within 30 days time. And then it further says such period shall not exceed 15 days. Again, the same premise that this 15 days delay can be condoned by the NCLT provided there's a sufficient clause. What is important is just like if we see, we go back to the discussion when we discussed Section 34.3 of the Arbitration Act, and we talked about the principle of exclusivity, doctrine of exclusivity. Similarly, in this case, there's an express exclusion. It says that the court, the NCLT, cannot condone the delay beyond 50 days. So this provision provides for special limitation, 29(2) of the Limitation Act, which we discussed earlier, for preferring an appeal, which excludes the applicability of Section 5 of the Act. Section 5 of the Limitation Act, which talks about the fact that the court can condone the delay, but such liberty cannot be exercised by the court as far as Section 61 is concerned. Similarly, Section 62 talks about an appeal before the Supreme Court. And on a question of law, the time prescribed is 45 days plus 15 days. And the way it is worded is more or less similar to Section 61. It says within a further period not exceeding 15 days. So this is also a special limitation for preferring an appeal, and Section 5 of the Limitation Act is not applicable. However, if we see Section 14, which talks about if the court, suppose in this case, suppose NCLT is not functioning in a particular day. So on the very next immediate working day, you can file it and you'll get a benefit of Section 14. Similarly, you'll also get another other benefits. If suppose there's a time period which the registry consumed to prepare a certified. So all those time periods and all other benefits under the Limitation Act will be applicable. Section 5 will not be applicable wherein a court has power to control delays beyond the prescribed limitation. Now this is the last point which I want to share, and what we can do is now we can take up the questions, and based on those questions I can elaborate further few more points. Kriti?
No, I request Meghna kindly take up the questions. Meghna, can you hear us?
Yes, sir.
Kindly take up the questions one by one.
Okay, sir. Good afternoon, ma'am. I am
Meghna.
Good afternoon, Meghna. Here are some queries asked by the viewers. So may I, ma'am?
Right. Please proceed.
Ma'am, first question is, under what provision of the Limitation Act the Supreme Court has extended the limitation during outbreak of COVID-19? Can you throw some light of this?
Right. So it is not really the Limitation Act. It is 146, Article 146, wherein the Supreme Court enjoys the immense power. Okay. And only the Supreme Court enjoys that power.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, the another question so, is
these are Right. Please, Meghna, please proceed.
Ma'am, the another question is by Rahul Singla, single. His question is, he wants to know about the maximum days to be allowed as condonation in different cases and different situations.
That itself will take another webinar. If he can be more specific in his question, then I'll be able to take it up.
Okay, ma'am.
I request Anu to proceed ahead, right? Anu, can you hear me?
Right, I can hear you. Meghna, if you can we take up other questions?
Yes, ma'am.
We'll try to come back to this question which has been raised by Rahul Singla, if time permits. Meanwhile, because that will take some time.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, the last question is Sonakshi. Does Limitation Act apply to special tribunals?
Right, like I said, which we have just discussed, under the Arbitration Act, if you see, Arbitration Act, ad hoc tribunal or institutional tribunal, limitation would be applicable. Similarly, NCLT and NCLET, Limitation Act would be applicable. So one has to see what special tribunals we are talking about. As far as these two are concerned, our Limitation Act is applicable. And to my understanding, I can't make an absolute statement. By and large, Limitation Act is applicable to even special tribunals, unless there's a special exclusion clause.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing such a crucial knowledge with us.
Thank you, everyone. That. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. No, I request now, may I have Rachi to have the time out for today's speaker? Rachi.
So, hello, ma'am. It's my immense pleasure to take a moment thanking you for being here with us today on our board. It has been a very informative session, ma'am, and the topic is also of immense importance. As we all know, it is important for all of us regarding the latest amendment and judicial developments. So thank you so much for enlightening us in this topic of Limitation Act 1963 with respect to insolvency and arbitration proceedings. It was an honor to have you on board, ma'am. And last but not the least, I would like to thank all of the viewers who have remained on board with us till the end. Really small journey. Thanks, Mitesh Mehra sir, also for giving this opportunity to moderate the today's webinar under your guidance. Ma'am, your presence on board always feel like a family. So I wish we will conduct more webinars like this in future. Thank you so much. Take care.
Thank you, everyone. Goodbye. Thank you, Nitesh. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Tanu. Thank you, Kriti. Thank you, Meghna. And thank you to Rachi for moderating today's webinar and helping me out to conduct the webinar. Thank you to all of you. We'll see you all very soon.
Thank you, sir.
Webinars. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you. Bye.